Africa Eye investigates the impact of the deadly coronavirus in one of the poorest communities in Kenya.
The Ministry of Health has confirmed the first coronavirus case in Kenya.
1 meter. That's a mkono, 1 meter.
With the coronavirus ripping through countries worldwide, Kenyan authorities are preparing for the worst. Mass casualties, civil unrest, and an economic meltdown. My name is Elijah Kanyi, a local journalist and a filmmaker. I was born in Mathare, one of the largest slums in Nairobi. Now, I am on the front line as my community prepares to fight this deadly pandemic.
There will be a daily curfew, with all movement by persons not authorized to do so being prohibited.
I witness heavy-handed policing and a series of tragic deaths.
Namulika hapa kwa ukuta. Alafu kaniambia, "Mama, nimegongwa."
And watch Mathare erupt as the community begin to ask, is the coronavirus cure far deadlier than the disease?
They are saying, it's not corona, it's the police who have killed the person.
This is my home, Mathare, one of the biggest slums in Nairobi. Over 500,000 people live here, within just 3 square miles. It's one of the most densely populated places in Kenya.
This is a place where I was born and raised. This is my neighborhood. I just want to take you on the setups of the houses in the slum. 12 houses. This one, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. And they share this one bathroom.
Lack of running water means outbreaks of disease are a common problem here. But now, we have a new kid on the block, coronavirus, highly contagious and deadly.
With the COVID, you're supposed to keep a distance of 1 meter. And as you can see, even my hand can stretch.
For over 10 years, I've been reporting on some of the most pressing issues affecting my community.
Ile sasa shida imenipata ni hii sewage. Juu sewage zikitoka huko juu zote zinamiminiwa hapa kwangu. Na nikijaribu kuteta hakuna mtu naona akinisaidia na hizi maji.
Poverty. Extrajudicial police killings. Political and ethnic violence. I even campaigned as an MP for my neighborhood in 2013.
The reason why I'm campaigning for MP is because since I was born, I've never seen any member of parliament who was born in Mathare.
But now, my community is facing its toughest challenge, a killer virus that is already at our door.
The Ministry of Health has confirmed the first coronavirus case in Kenya. I therefore urge all Kenyans, wash your hands with soap and water, maintain a distance of at least 1 meter.
1 meter. That's a mkono, 1 meter.
The arrival of coronavirus threatens to devastate the fragile economy of Mathare. Men and women here rely on work outside of the slum. If they cannot travel to the city, they will be unable to work. Daniel Carter worked as a builder, but because of coronavirus, he's now unable to work.
Because now we are not going to job, no places to earn our bread. And now it's very difficult for us, because money for food is a problem.
But the cost in human lives could be far worse. Seeing this illegal pub selling busa, a home-brewed alcohol, made from millet, makes me realize just how deadly an impact coronavirus could have on this tight-knit community.
When we wake up, normally we come to our base. We just wait. If there are no cases of anything to come, we take some time and party out. Maybe chew some cut. Have some drinks. That's what's normal. This thing is real. We have seen it in China, in Italy. We have seen it all over the world. Maybe if we are affected, it's when we'll be afraid and maybe keep that distance. When there is no those cases in our place, nobody will fear. Nobody will be scared until somebody dies.
To young men in Mathare like Daniel, social distancing is just not an option.
Are you not afraid?
We are afraid, but you know, it's normal in Africa. We never stay away from each other. My friends are like my brothers. When I'm down, they are the ones to lift me. So it's very hard for me to take even a single day without seeing my friend.
In Mathare, it's a culture. Everything that people do, they do it together. If it's having fun, they spend their time having fun together despite the fear of coronavirus. So far, Kenya has avoided the worst of the pandemic. By the 25th of March, only 28 cases have been reported, with just one death related to coronavirus. None of them were found in Mathare. But dark clouds are beginning to gather.
There will be a daily curfew from 7 p.m. to 5 a.m. with all movement by persons not authorized to do so being prohibited.
The first night of the government curfew is approaching. Mathare residents know it's the police who will be enforcing it, and that they have a history of violence and brutality. Kenya's independent police oversight body recorded over 3,000 incidents of abuse by the police in 2019 alone. In Huruma Ward of Mathare, I see for myself how police are enforcing the curfew. The very next morning after the curfew is enforced, my community wakes to news of a tragedy.
A family right here in Nairobi is in mourning following the fatal shooting of a 13-year-old boy, allegedly by a police officer.
Coronavirus has yet to reach Mathare, but has already claimed its first victim.
The boy, known as Hussein Moyo, was killed in the Kiamaiko area on the first night of the curfew.
In the apartment where the boy was killed, I met his mother, Khadija.
Aisha kambeba kampeleka huko chini. Akamlaisha sitting room hapo chini. Kijana wangu kuna 13 years. Hata si mkubwa tangi kwa huko chini amchuti huko anasema labda alikuwa ameenda kuzurura. Hapa juu, hebu piga picha kutoka huko mpaka hapa. Hebu toka nje hapo ulize. Kila mtu anampenda mtoto wake, kila mtu. Ako na heshima, hakuna kitu hata anaambia kwa mtu. Mwenyezi Mungu atalipishia. Inshallah.
As the family prepare to bury Yasin, I met with his father, Hussein.
Na ni mtoto alikuwa ametulia third floor, ghorofa ya tatu, askari ana shoot. Hiyo inamaanisha aji. Na askari tu alipompiga yeye alitoka akaenda lakini. Hata sisi tutaamua sasa corona itupate. Mchana tunaogopa corona, usiku ni marisazi tunapigwa.
News of Yasin's death has spread throughout the community, creating a climate of fear and anger. Now, the residents are demanding answers. A delegation of senior police and local officials have been dispatched to the family home. Condolences are offered and promises are made of a full investigation.
Rais mwenyewe Uhuru Kenyatta. Rais mwenyewe ameniambia nilete pole zake na pia kwa TV. Sio kama kuna wale waliona amesema pole kwa niaba ya serikali kwa kifo ya Yasin. Serikali inapigana na corona, haipigani na wananchi. Inspector General of Police ametuma huyu protocol officer kwa Inspector General anaitwa Bwana Omolo.
Habari zenu hapa. Na ukiniona hapa amenituma kwa pole zake ili nipigie pole. Amehakikisha hii jambo lazima itafika.
But to the grieving parents, the official's words offer little comfort.
Katuambia haki itapatikana na haki itatendeka. Kijana wangu ameniacha, nampenda. Hata wengi, wacha sisi wale tulilia wazazi, hata wadogo wake wengi wako hapa rafiki Azili walilia. Kwa hivyo siwezi ongea zaidi. Niko poa.
But even as Yasin's parents grieve, more allegations of police brutality are beginning to emerge. Few days ago when I met Mzee Maina, he told me about his son who had lost his eye through police brutality. I joined him to go to the hospital to meet Michael, his son. Like hundreds of other young men in Mathare, Michael Maina rides a boda boda or a motorbike taxi for a living. We put Michael's claims to the Kenya police, but they declined to comment. A few days later, I visit Michael at home.
Nilifeel mbaya. Nimeka miaka ngapi na macho mbili, baba. Macho nisha grow nao miaka 30 na. Nimeka nao miaka hiyo yangu yote. Lakini dakika ya mwisho ndo nakuja kutolewa macho. Njua karao. Na mimi mwenyezi ati mimi ni mwizi. Hayo ilifanya nikafeel guilty sasa zaidi. Guilty zaidi. Nikuona yenyewe kweli ya fadhali hata. Nilikuwa nimeamua mbaya Kanyi. Fadhali hata kufa basi. Ingekuwa hata nikunimaliza ungenimaliza ningesema tu ni sawa. Kurudi job ya boda boda tena. Na macho moja itakuwa bado ni ngumu bro. Nimebaki sasa nimevunjwa mkono mmoja unaona? Yaani kama nimekatwa mkono mmoja. This serious kushinda karao. Karao ndio serious. Yeye ndio serious kushinda corona. Eh? Sasa fadhali hata corona ikupate wana kushinda karao akupate.
Michael has filed an official complaint but holds out little hope of getting justice.
Ah, lakini mimi naona ni karao wa Kenya peke yake. Yana piga hesabu yeye yuko above the law. Hakuna mali utampeleka.
On the 15th of April, the Kenyan government made wearing a mask in public compulsory.
To begin wearing protective masks immediately.
This point, people are not putting on the mask to protect themselves from the virus. People are putting on the mask to protect themselves from being arrested by the police. And this is very sad because even the mask that people are using, they're not up to standard. They can't afford a professional mask.
On the 4th of May, I receive a tip-off about another alleged act of police brutality. A dead body has been found on the streets of Mathare. It's claimed that he had been beaten by police during the previous night's curfew. As I reach the scene, I am approached by a man who claims to have witnessed the entire incident.
Jana, mimi nilikuwa kwa hii barabara yetu ya Dajo. Huu mzee mwenye amedeti hapa, Madaraka. Alikuwa mbele yangu na polisi wanamkimbiza. Wakampiga ya kwanza, hakuanguka. Ya pili ndo wakamfuata wakimtega. Akuja akampigia hapa hivi kama ameinua mkono juu. Mimi mwenyewe hata mimi nilikuwa namfuata nyuma, mimi nikaingia chuo.
Alafu anasema ni corona, corona gani na madari.
Kitabilo linga di kwa mfuko. Polisi linga kwa mfuko. Kwa mfuko.
According to the witness, it's all too easy to get caught outside your home during curfew.
Tusitafutie pesa, sisi wenyewe tusaidiwi, na hata serikali tusaidii. Tunatafuta pesa yetu na jasho yetu. Kama wanatuona, wajua wanafanya. Si ati kutuletea mapolisi, kusema ati watumue. Huu si corona, kwani ama yeye ni corona ameuliwa. Na nikupigwa alipigwa na karao. Ama muende angalie shingo. Kama dhana kudanganya, kuna bali hapa amepigwa nikiona hivi.
Suddenly, the police arrive. They try to gather witness statements, but the crowd are angry. They smell a cover-up, and they fear the police will claim the man died of coronavirus rather than at the hands of the police. The mood turns ugly, and the police are chased away. With the police gone, the crowd quickly hatch a plan to transport the dead body to the main police station and invite the media to witness what they see as evidence of brutality by the Kenyan police.
Claim the police killed the guy, and the reason why they're taking the body is because everyone who is taken from the slum to the mortuary can be said this is a corona victim, and that's why they're taking the body to the police station.
We put these claims to the Kenyan police service, but they refuse to respond. The procession heads towards Mutaiga police station, where the crowd believes the officers responsible for the death are based. But as the demonstrators approach, the police respond with tear gas.
Since we started filming, there has been no case of coronavirus in Mathare. But so far, 3 people have been killed. As you can see today, people had to maintain the body of the person who was killed to get the publicity and also to get justice for the guy who was killed.
But the station's commanding officer is not impressed by the demonstrators and is quick to dismiss their claims of a cover-up.
Those are just rumors which we cannot rile. If you see, we try to talk to them, to present themselves with the information regarding the same. None came in. Those who are just fully gone, who are very, very idle there. So they used that opportunity to celebrate.
I asked the commanding officer, Rafael Gar, whether the case would be investigated and if the officers responsible would face punishment.
The investigation is being conducted by the DCI, an independent body, so it is going to be very, very fair. We are very, very open, very friendly.
But the officers' assurances sound optimistic at best. Over 10,000 cases of police brutality have been reported by Kenya's Independent Policing Oversight Authority since 2013. Only 6 have led to a conviction. As tensions rise between the community and the police, the deadly virus continues to spread across Nairobi. The threat to Mathare is now very real. I've come to the offices of Medicine Sans Frontiers to meet the frontline health workers battling the virus.
I work at MSF as an emergency medical technician. I washed my hands at the gate with chlorine. My temperature is taken. I'm asked a couple of questions pertaining to the COVID questionnaire. We have 3 ambulances. We're working with Jojo.
Hi, Jojo.
That is Salano.
This is Jojo. We'll be Jojo the whole day, Jojo.
Salano.
And then you wait for calls as the call center dispatches.
It's not long before Rose and her team receive an emergency call from Mathare.
No, we have a call. Call from Mr. Michael, 21 years old. Not able to talk, not able to walk for the past 3 days.
Jojo, mwisho.
Like many other Mathare residents, the patient's family cannot afford private health care. Her family contact MSF and plead for urgent medical attention. The distressed lady is carried into the ambulance by Rose and a family member.
We have tried codes. From my findings, the fact that she's already unresponsive warrants red. Red means she's a high priority patient. It's an emergency.
But the fear of coronavirus means very few hospitals will be prepared to admit the patient.
Most facilities will reject her right now because of the history of fever and the cough. They might tell us to take her to Mbagathi first. So we wait and see. Sasa, akon responsive, akon fevers.
You are told to go to Mbagathi. Will that be a COVID suspect case?
Yes.
What does that mean?
That I'm already exposed. It should have infected many people because she's living with some relatives. I've seen them with masks, but they are not wearing them properly. It's just covering the mouth. Maybe they're just wearing masks on the outside so that they wouldn't be caught by police.
And what are we waiting right now?
We're waiting for the call center to get back to us with if the patient has been accepted in one of the facilities. That's them calling right now. Charlie, Charlie. Yes. Kenyatta kwenyewe.
A hospital outside of Mathare has agreed to take the patient. But time is running out.
It's difficult to differentiate patients with common respiratory illnesses and COVID right now. There's a lot of people in this population with tuberculosis. You wouldn't know whether they are COVID suspects or not. That's the challenge that we have right now. referral facilities right now are testing every patient who has respiratory issues for COVID.
And if it's positive?
If it's positive, me and you go to quarantine.
2 days later, Rose calls to tell me the results of the patient's coronavirus test.
Hello?
Hey.
Hey, Mambo. How did it go?
Me, I'm just shaking.
Eh?
I'm just in shock.
Why?
She turned positive.
That was my biggest fear.
Why? Let me call after and then you know what next.
Now my heartbeat has gone up.
Rose and I had to have our own coronavirus tests and self-isolate until the results were known. My journey on the corona frontline was now over. Sadly, the patient did not recover. A few days later, she passed away. The coronavirus had claimed its first casualty in Mathare. These images of her funeral were given to me by her family. No one can tell how many more victims this deadly virus will claim. But one thing is for sure, coronavirus is now among us in Mathare. For as long as I can remember, the people of Mathare have felt abandoned by the government and abused by the police. We have learned to be resilient, but this may be one battle we cannot fight alone.